To hear from you guys if you have any ideas what it is that we're listening to and who it is, and yeah, anyone wants to give it a shot? Okay, I see someone here in the chats.
Hi Thokozani, lovely to meet you and welcome to the department and congrats on the postdoc. Yeah, I mean, just listening to that, I was a bit distracted by, it's actually very funny that you're saying, you know, let's forget about the emails and the likes and the what, because even in preparation for this, I'm like trying to just get through some emails before coming to listen. So the minute you said that, I was just like, oh, okay. But I was a bit distracted by the quality of the song. And I was wondering, you know, if that's actually the quality from your side when you're playing it, if it's that glitchy and not pure. Because I know that sometimes when you're trying to play videos on Zoom, it like glitches and it's not actually quite pure. So yeah, I was just wondering about that. Like, oh shucks, like is this the consequence of the technology that we're actually not hearing it in the way that you want us to hear it? And actually possibly very, very different to how you are hearing it. Because when you are sitting there playing it, you're probably hearing it the way it's supposed to be heard, but by the time it sort of gets to us, it has completely transformed, despite the fact that we're supposedly listening to it at the same time.
Okay, and any guess on who it is?
No, I was gonna say something, but I don't wanna make a fool of myself, so I'll just refrain from guessing.
Anyone else wants to give it a shot?
I've heard the song so many times, but I don't remember the title or the name. Yeah, but it's a very familiar.
I mean, I know this, isn't this track or some version of it in The Lion King?
Oh, at least we have someone who watches cartoons, yeah.
I mean, I thought we all know it from there.
Like, I don't know where it comes from, but I mean, for me, it's familiar literally through Disney.
In the jungle, the mighty jungle.
Yeah.
Interesting so, how the familiarity, but I mean, even if I can say Imbube, but I actually don't know who composed it.
Okay. At least we have one person who has the name right. So I want to say to you, this is the song that was one of the most contested intellectual property rights issues in South Africa. One of the most contested ever, because this is a song sung by a young man who came from Singa and went to the mines and fell in love with this genre of people who were dancing and wearing smart suits together and making sure that their creases are very well ironed and lifting up their pants delicately as they move and gesture together. And so him and his group of friends, who call themselves the Evening Birds, they took on, they dressed up nicely in their things, and then they were brought into the studio. They brought in probably one of the studios, the studio in Roodepoort, which had been established by a man called Hugh Tracy, who had an interest in sound recording. And recording particularly these mine workers as they were singing their traditional songs, some which are not traditional, but were songs that were actually being composed in that contemporary situation. But anyway, so there it goes. Solomon Linda's Mbube becomes a hit and gets absorbed abroad, and numerous people make hits out of the song. There's a big 1960s rock hit, I think, called Wimowe, you know, where this track it first begins to explode, and then it gets taken over and replicated in a number of ways and picked up by a number of musicians, that world music musicians and stuff like that, until the Disney version, which is obviously now, it's like, that's when it's like at the biggest level of being cheesy. But also around that time was around the time when there was beginning to be a consciousness of the injustice of the past and possibly making a way to honor Mr. Linda's legacy. Yeah, so I wanted to start with that, but also I like the things that Portia suggested, you know, because it begins to me to bring the level of listening to that aspect of saying, what are we hearing? And I'm hoping that by the end of today we'll be more conscious of what are we experiencing from an African point of view. So I want to then start follow with an argument that has been expressed very well by Professor Njabulo Ndebele, and that argument is that if Black lives really matter, then they must first be known and not simply guessed. You know? And how I interpret what Ndebele here is saying is somewhat similar to something that Sartre was saying in the 1940s in his thinking about freedom. And Sartre was writing about the realm of saying to decide and designate a field as unknowable is a kind of voluntarist position, and with its implications of mysticism and transcendence, you know, this idea that freedom will be attained through transcendence. And so, in a way, what Sartre sees in this is a voluntarist position, and he begins to suggest a shift from unknowable to the not yet known, you know. I don't know if that makes it sense, the shift from the unknowable to the not yet known. So, and for me, what I understand by not yet known is a potentiality, you know, of something to be discovered, to be investigated, to be probed. And so my, if I go back to what Ndebele is saying, is that my sense is that African cultural repertoire are not yet not yet, and it seems as though there is a somewhat of a voluntarist position where they are consigned to a level of being unknowable. And part of that consignment of, into the realm of the unknowable is to serve the particular ends of the regime of science and the regime of art as we know it in the world. And so precisely because this knowledge disrupts that, it is called unreason in that sense. And when you look at how Foucault classifies and explains madness and its delicate consignment into a particular institution in the West, and how the progressive development of this category of madness, and that as it's being discovered, it is also being made up, you know. And so, and then when you look at it from an African perspective, you can see as well that it's no wonder that many women during the colonial period, African women were labeled as mad women, whether we're talking about Nondeta Nkwenkwe and others, you know. And so I think that somehow there's in this category, there's something that is there for us. And not that we as African people need to necessarily be trying to go for what is ours and something that is already a lived experience and now seek to explain it via Foucault. But somehow we find ourselves in the situation where we are in this an atmosphere of validation, which is created by the achievement orientation that we found ourselves in our lifetime, which has the university as its ideal. And so somehow as we find ourselves in this moment of being in this ideal, we are desperately also trying to explain, and sometimes also trying to explain to our former oppressor what we already know ourselves. And in that effort of explaining, sometimes we then end up trying to explain what is ours through Western literature and thought. But my understanding of that is not necessarily one of co-option, of trying to impose Western ideas, but the ideal for me, the aim for me is an epistemic disruption. And sometimes those disruptions can happen inwardly and outwardly as well. And both of those options are both active. And I don't believe that the one is more activist than the other. So my question then for you is that what kind of African cultural repertoire are we hearing in Mbube? Or what are we seeing or visualizing? And does it matter? Ndebele would go on and then say, what is the status of the township? You know? Or is it women who are always just being guests and the township rowdy, the noisy township women that we see on all the Mzansi magic stories, you know, the gangster township guy? Are these tropes necessarily self-invented tropes? Are they being gassed, and we are subtly being seduced by that effort of guessing, and we are then not investigating, and not probing for our art, whether it's our art or our, because as we're seeking to define an artistic voice or a cultural vision that is ours, it goes without saying that we will tap into the African archive for a as a resource. But to tap into the African archive as a resource, it can't just be a Wakanda kind of business, you know. People have gone through COVID, they're very serious and they want serious things. So, and I think that is our effort. That is our task in our art and in our creativity. I suspect that that may be our task for this time. So I want to give it all over to you guys and hear what you have to say.
I'm wondering if maybe, you know, we can talk a little bit more about the African archive, and ways in which one can tap into it. I mean, as you're suggesting, but I wanna, I'm trying to see if we can maybe, you know, open up the discussion about, you know, shape and form of the African archive. And then, of course, how we experience it. So, I mean, having listened to Imbube, you know, you know, how is that experience of the African archive?
Difficult questions. I think the African archive, we must also admit that, because what you note is that our West African counterparts, for example, you would know, Nomusa, that our West African counterparts have two advantages in them, is that historically, even pre-colonially, they tended to have quite strong centralized kingdoms or religious institutions, which meant that even after the Anglophone and Francophone disruptions that were colonial, it left some of those cultures more or less intact. And as a result, there's something of a commonality even across the Francophone-Anglophone divide. And then now when you look at our situation from a Southern African point of view, is that we don't come from a history where we've had that freedom, first of all, to explore in the dynamic and philosophical ways that happened in West Africa in the 60s and 70s, where people were exploring dimensions of Africanity and doing that through film, through visual means and so forth. And so one can say that from all these attempts that have been happening there, there is something of an accumulation of an African archive. And our situation in Southern Africa is a little bit more shaky, I would say, partly because of the isolationism of this part of the world for some time, vis-a-vis the rest of the African continent. And so my sense is that that African archive, even to even name it and say it's this or that, is to make it, because it is being built up by us as we begin to have a space to write, to create, to express. I have no kind of conception of a pre-colonial authenticity of that archive. I wouldn't say that there's a kind of authenticity that one can then tap to, but we've seen various people experimenting in various sophisticated ways, whether it's the credo mutuas of this world or the mazisukunenas of this world, but it's not enough. I think it's not yet enough for us to be able to be really robust and have a definition for ourselves in the relation to the rest of Africa. So that locality in a space and all that quickly adopt to American trends and UK trends. And so like, oh no, if you want something that looks close to whatever is trendy elsewhere in the world, come to the South African biennials. but to have a voice and an artistic presence, around the world, just like as they're able to point at this Cuban painting, but I no doubt this is Cuban. I'm sure the people would be able to do the same. Not as the more we accumulate. I don't know. That's my point.
Firstly, thank you for those points, but I'm also just curious about because I mean, you've addressed the absence. But I think in many ways, we do have elements of an archive through like the institution of language, which has remained even after the sort of intrusion of like colonial settlers, et cetera, et cetera. So I think like, what do we mean when we mean African archive? Are we talking about the institution of language? Are we talking about creative sort of offerings through music, cinema, and visual art? Because I understand you, the points you've made, but I also think that we also cannot focus too strongly on the absence, because I think we do have some bits of an archive that also just need to be focused on. I don't know if it's naive, but it's just, yeah, a point.
No, I don't think it's naive at all. It's a point, and I think it's true as well. But what came to mind for me as you were speaking was also the other emphasis that I think is part of what I'm trying to say, is the importance and the need for the role of criticism as a practice. And I think part of that lack, or what appears to me as a lack, has to do with the role of criticism. And we have inadequate space and inadequate places and respect for the role of the critic. Not critic as in critique and French critique, things, fancy things like that, no. I mean, art criticism in its particular form, or literary criticism, music criticism, but also broader cultural criticism, the kind of cultural criticism of H.I.E. Jom, for example, who did so in the pages of Ilanga Lase Natal in the 1930s and 1940s. So, and I think this role of cultural criticism and art criticism is very delicate and proves to be on shaky ground, because when you look at people like Jom and them, they were journalists, you know, and a lot of the people now today who have an interest in this kind of work, their only point of view and point of reference is the academy. And that is not where criticism is made. You know, when I go back to my studies in music, and perhaps you guys in visual arts, it's slightly different. In music, it would happen that it's clear that there's the musicologist, and the musicologists are the ones who go and look at the archives and look at the music scores and things like that. And then there are music critics. The music critics are the ones who would look at concerts that are happening and would look at certain renditions by certain musicians. And the critics as well would be able to look at a whole oeuvre of a collector's work and be able to provide criticisms. And what then began to happen through the post-modernity is that the role of criticism and music theory and musicology began to merge together like that. And I suspect that with art history, similar things have happened, that art criticism has become become absorbed under art history. But that role is actually very different and has a very critical role to, silly critical, has a very important role to play in fostering and growing a cultural discourse.
I really like that analysis of criticism. I have like 100 different thoughts running through my head, which is why I haven't said anything up until now, more because there's an excess than a lack. But I'm thinking about this thing of the archive and also your thing of criticism, and maybe the sense that it's not the fact that the content is not there, not the fact that we haven't been making throughout time, but rather the fact that we've had an intrusion on the way we like orient ourselves in relation to what we're making. And I think maybe criticism is an answer. Maybe kind of bringing the arts into a space where we understand them as part of normal life, as opposed to some kind of separate thing, is some sort of an answer. But I'm also kind of interested in Ndebele's idea about the unknowable versus the not yet known. Also in relation to the West, because there's this weird tension in creating the African archive, and I mean that in the sense of the colonial archive, where Black people are constantly always either unknowable or kind of overly known. So there's this like ethnographic typing of Blackness and Black culture, which is like this over visibility that is not, the West is not rendered in that same way. But then at the same time, there's this unknowability that's articulated in different ways, which is, so there's this kind of tension between being overly known and seen and violated by this gaze, and then the other side of it, which is being unknowable, which is kind of interesting because unknowability, if we look at the West and Western modernity, is a kind of cultural mystique and has like a lot of power to it, whereas unknowability and Blackness is another kind of thing. And then one other comment I want to add to this mix is, you're talking about criticism, and I'm also kind of frustrated maybe by the way art criticism unravels itself in South Africa. Because at the same time that you're talking about we need an archive and we need to be known, there's also within the new South Africa a tendency to kind of re-hyper-visibilize ourselves and kind of re-tribalize in the sense of the tribal as a colonial invention, to talk about identity and to over-commit to identities created by colonialism. And I feel like it's all of this attempt towards an archive, but in some ways we reconstitute the colonial archive. So maybe criticism in some other way, like you're talking about it, is an answer. But I do believe that criticism needs to kind of revolve around, and what did you say? The not yet known, some sort of opacity or Black consciousness, or I don't know, a meeting point a meeting point of knowing ourselves and our histories, but also a refusal of kind of operating within the colonial archive in that kind of a way, which is what I see happening now in the art world, like an over-identification. yeah, that's all my ramblings for now.
Wow, you're flowing. I'm like, you flowing, you're flowing. I'm like, yeah, man, keep it running. I'm writing notes here. Thank you, thank you. I mean, these are tremendous reflections, and they are arresting questions, and they have me opening up a whole bunch of things here on my computer now, but I won't bore you with everything. But I want to distinguish between two things that I think for me are distinguishable. And that is the unknowability versus the not yet known, and the thing I'm talking about. And another posture, which is the posture and the space of indiscipline. And which is a zone that African subjects position in relation to the European Enlightenment project. And it is a space of tactics which is mended from the past, but also indiscipline offers the subject its tactical recourse. And now here I'm quoting from a writing of Bogomil Javisky, a negative. Indiscipline offers the subject its tactical recourse, a negative one, to boot. Indiscipline makes it possible to resist, to remove oneself from the action of the other, to act as if one has been converted, sometimes indeed to the point of believing it oneself. And this space does not allow one to impose one's own priorities, you know, and that's what Javeski says about this space. Are you still with me, guys? Just wave if you're still with me. So, okay. And in explaining indiscipline like this, I'm saying in my argument about indiscipline is that the indiscipline does in fact allow for the possibility of a third space, a place out of access, a space that cannot be breached even by reason itself. And that is a space of linguistic and existential autonomy. This space of linguistic and existential autonomy, which my suspicion, my sense that is what the African subject is in the process of uncovering. You know, not the realm of indiscipline, because the realm of indiscipline was a particular posture towards particular institutions that one was at war with, but also trying to amend them and absorb them in certain ways. So yeah, the space of indiscipline for me, I understand the space of indiscipline to be something else. And that is the tension that we are also negotiating against as we begin to internalize these institutions that once possibly contributed to oppression and make them our own. You know, it's a different war. And then this other thing about knowability is that now when we own these institutions, and if we really believe that we own them, then we have to start genuinely speaking about ourselves. You know, we can no longer hold that same posture as before. And we also can't just be defiant in jail, just like before. You know what I mean? So there's a tactic of understanding what is yours, firstly, because you must first believe that this is yours. And if you don't believe that it's yours, you are not capable of this kind of second level of defining the space. The space that we once called indiscipline, that is, but that is capable of something else. So, and unless we have that belief in ourselves, then we are always likely to be responding from the trauma of what happened to us and what was done to us. And even when the power is, as C.L.R. James says, and says, power was in the streets, but no one was ready. No one knew how to seize power. Yeah. So that's my response to what you have to say, And I do think the idea of us overcommitting, if you can say that again about overcommitting, you said something about overcommitting.
Overcommitting to identity, but to colonially formed and apartheid identity.
Yes, but and I guess I'm saying there, we must not be rushed to our truth, you know, and we need to be patient with ourselves and with each other. And that's where the criticism comes in, because the criticism is there to act like I'm being judgmental. But the opportunity with that is that someone else is then able to bring in their own ideas about what they have against you. But if we're all like kind of breaking eggs around each other and we're not able to say, that exhibition is rubbish. And this is why, this and this and this and this and this and this. And that's the explosive things that are going to make our culture start to happen again. We can't wait for someone to every few years to show a penis of a president, and then for us to all rush into the galleries again.
I think we'll have to close. So I just wanted to thank you so much to you, Thokozani, for the time, and thank you so much to all the attendants for being here and for all the contributions. We move up. We move up.